I think that, you know, the first thing of, you know, anybody new to the industry needs to do is, you know, really look at the model and consider what they're getting into. Payment facilitation and many of the models are a heavy lift. And looking to work with somebody that can provide the flexibility across the models, you know, should you be best suited as an ISV, as an ISO, as a payment facilitator, as a referral partner, as a marketplace, you know, what's the model? Does the platform provide you the kind of flexibility to be able to grow into it? And then work with people who know the industry. You know, I think selection is about trust. It's about the expertise that they can provide to you. And the people behind the people that you see, you know, the salesman's the front guy, but who's the team of people that you're going to be working with behind the scenes?
I think it's interesting because we see lots of folks that perhaps historically wouldn't have come to us and said, I want to be a payment facilitator, wanting to understand what that involves. I think historically as Vantiv and WorldPay, we've done really good jobs of that fully wholesale PayFac support, and then, hey, kick us a lead over the fence and we'll sign it as a referral partner. And we're obviously trying to evolve that spectrum so that we do a better job there for folks that perhaps aren't quite ready to be a payment facilitator, but want all of those. I think control is a really good point. You know, why do you want to become a payment facilitator is my number one question for folks. Is it control? Generally, the answer is yes. Is it control? Yes. You know, it's the experience, the how monies are paid out, how it ties into your software, how easy it is to sign up, how easy it is to board. Those are all factors that are really good reasons to say yes to becoming a payment facilitator. When economic decisions are number one, that's a very challenging conversation because those are important, and they lead us into whether that's ultimately the right decision, because it has to be economically viable and there has to be return on investment. But if that's where we start, generally that's where I see folks not necessarily wanting to go down that road, or eventually it just falls down because you can't get enough economic value sometimes, and that's all the drivers are.
So, you know, we try to take a consultative approach, really. Why do you want to be a payment facilitator? Is it control? Is it you want to stand in the forefront? Do you want to take liability? Don't you want to take liability? How much investment from investment? How much work do you want to do? So we very much take a walk versus run approach. Do you want to walk before you run, or do you want to run? Because we can support both aspects of it based off of the client's needs. And if it's short term today, and you know, maybe a certain duration of time, they know that they want to get some of our assistance for maybe an underwriting aspect or risk. We allow them the flexibility to, you know, work with us or tell us what aspects they do want to handle versus not, and we will grow with them.
I mean, what we see is that there's not a one size. So there's not a you should be completely dating and piece it all together. And there's rarely a case where I would suggest go to one place and buy lock, stock, and barrel, whatever that offering is. There's a lot more flexibility you can have by having different components, different pieces. Now, what I most commonly see is that you're already an ISV, you're already an ISO, you've already done some of this development, and you've already created connections with gateways, you already solved for some of the components. And you know, we have all the components. If you wanted everything from us, great, we can provide everything. But what we're more typically gonna do is really talk to you about what you've already built, what you like about what you've already built, what those components are, and say, hey, we can continue to use those, and let us show you what else we have for the pieces you haven't built, or how you can, if you have a problem spot, how you can make that better. You know, the one that is very obvious that, you know, Tyler's referring to is there's an obvious bundle with us in that we're always going to be your processor, and Bank of America is going to be your acquirer, and Bank of America has huge, significant, you know, influence in the issuance space, huge issuer of cards, and so that relationship with Visa, with MasterCard, with the card brands is a little bit different than you might see otherwise.
I think historically, and I think Osama may have brought this up in his opening keynote, that PayFac were in the e-com space and it was card not present. And we've seen this evolution of payment facilitators tying payments to technology across the board. You know, as Matt Doker spoke earlier, Five Stars, they have a broad swath of retail customers as a payment facilitator set up for amazing success, right? We have restaurant customers that are supporting restaurants. I talked earlier about vending and what they've done. Those are all card-present environments that historically would not have been really thought of as payment facilitation. And so, you know, it's important to have great ways in for processing to allow that flexibility to do EMV, card-present, tap, you know, mobile, tap, sort of omni-type solutions. But I do think that it's really, are you delivering payments alongside technology? Or are you just selling payments? If you're just selling payments, then you probably should be an ISO. And that's going to give you much more flexibility, and that's what your organization is set up for. And you don't really need to take on all of the regulatory burden that a PayFac needs. But I think it's really exciting in the sense that we're seeing that shift to where that tradition, and that's exciting for me and for us perhaps on this panel, not so exciting if you're, you know, an ISO agent walking and talking, trying to sell merchant deals every day, that you don't have a technology stack beside you.
And I think that it's an and also, not an either or. I think right. We're seeing the ISO market add the payment facilitation market. And I think some of the movement in the industry right now is more additive. You know, either existing, their early on payment processor didn't cover certain markets or didn't have certain capabilities. And so adding a payment, a second processor for a specific geography, for a specific line of business is becoming more than a hard cut over.
I thought this was a great panel. A couple things I heard. The first thing was it may be commoditized and often settled, but there's a lot of services that these customers need, and that's less so. Two, there is a threat. I didn't hear anybody debunk the threat from new API-driven companies that are in payment processing. Three, there's some walk-run opportunities. And four, it really, there isn't that much switching. There's been some adding, maybe some PFs that have added a second source, but I'm not hearing that there is a lot of switching, interestingly, which lends its case, at least backward looking, to its a marriage.